Okay. So we have somewhere around 155 participants. Good evening all of you. Basically it's good afternoon, but okay, whatever. Anyways, so as we were doing yesterday, I will be going ahead and sharing the screen with you people for the RC PPT that we were doing. And in today's class, however, we'll be focusing more on solving questions and looking at what we have to do when we are reading the reading comprehensions and after we read the reading comprehensions. Okay, so yesterday we had a class on reading speed, what are the different ways in which we can read faster, and what are the question types, no? And we have answered a few questions yesterday. We have answered 3 questions yesterday. Correct? Am I right? We answered 3 questions yesterday. Sirisha, you were absent for yesterday's class. Okay. Sirisha, don't worry. Actually, we will be uploading this recording on our website. Okay. So you can go and you can maybe watch the video. It'll be pretty clear for you. Okay. All right. Anyways, let me share the screen and then we can go ahead with our slide. This was the last slide that we looked at. Let me share the screen again. Yes, and this time I have disabled the participants' annotation. Okay, so this was the last slide that we looked at. Yes, all of you. Okay, so now I will give you tips on what we should be doing while we are reading the passage. Okay. Yesterday we discussed what we should be doing before we read the passage, correct? So today I will be giving you tips on what we should be doing while we are reading the passage, okay? Now, first and the foremost thing, while you're reading the passage, please do not try to remember all the details of the passage because you won't be able to remember all the details, okay? See, a lot of people will tell you that if you remember the details or if you note down the details somewhere, it'll be very useful for you while you're solving the questions and all. But no, that's not true. Okay? The more you're trying to remember the details of the passage, the less you're focusing on understanding the passage. Okay? Now, what I need you to do is when you're reading the passage, I want you to question the author at every point. Why is the author telling this? Okay, if he's telling this, then what? If this thing is happening in this passage, then what else can happen? Okay, I want you to be able to question the passage at every point, but I don't want you to remember all the details from the passage. Okay, remember, yesterday we saw 3 types of questions, right? Direct or factual questions, implied idea questions, and vocabulary based questions. Yes? Now, the details of the passage will be only useful for you when you are getting a direct or factual type of a question. And if you are getting a direct or factual type of question, you can immediately go back to the passage if you remember and you understand. Basically, if you understand what the passage has spoken about, you can immediately go back to the passage and look at the answer and mark the answer. Correct? So you don't need to specifically think about even going and remembering each part of the passage. All right? Okay. Second one. When you are reading the passage, for each paragraph, I want you to mention the one main point of that paragraph. Okay? Suppose your paragraph or your passage has 5 different paragraphs. Okay? Now, each paragraph in that passage, I want you to be able to summarize into 1 to 2 lines. Now, what will happen when you summarize this passage into 1 to 2 lines? Those 1 to 2 lines will give you the required inferences that you should be drawing. Am I clear? Boys and girls, are you able to understand what I'm saying? Am I audible to all of you guys? Okay, so yeah, you are able to understand, right? Okay, all right, fine. Okay. Now, the third thing is I want you to try and form an impression on what the author is trying to convey. Remember, yesterday also we had this big issue, no? That either we are listening to the examiner or we are listening to the author. Okay, Abhi, am I audible now? Okay, so either we are listening to the author or we are listening to the examiner. And we should always listen to the author because all our questions are asking us according to the author's point of view, what should we do? Correct? So always make sure that no matter what you are doing, you are trying to form an impression on what the author is trying to convey. Okay, you should try to understand what is the author even, why is the author telling it like this? If the author has given you 5 points about something, you should try to think, why is the author telling you like this? Okay? All right. Now, as I promised, today we are going to solve a lot of questions on passages. I've gotten 3 good passages for you. This is passage number 1, all of you. And in my clock, the time is 3:41. Just give me one moment. Yeah, in my clock, the time is 3:41. So you guys can take maybe till 3:46. There is no problem in life. You'll break it into small parts and you'll try to solve it, no? The same way, try to break this passage into small parts and then try to understand it. Okay, now the first few passages that you are going to solve, it is going to take you a little bit longer than what you expect. And that is completely natural. Okay. I'll share with you a story that, okay, it's my story. Okay. It's not of my friend or anything. See, usually people will say this one of my friend's story, this one of my student's story. This is not anyone's story. It's my story. Okay. The first year that I was preparing for CAT, I could not solve all the 6 passages in the exam. Okay. So what I did was that I solved 4 passages and then immediately I went on to the verbal reasoning section because I knew that would take lesser time. So always remember, guys, if you are not able to read very fast, that's completely fine. You just started out, right? Okay. And if you're not able to get the proper understanding, that's also completely fine. We don't need to be fast as long as we are smart. Okay. There's a story that I usually like narrating. So I'll tell you the story about 2 lions. There were 2 lions, Jack and Jim. Okay. Now, Jack and Jim grew up together. They were brothers, but they were, you know, like cousins. Jack came from a family of lions who was very, very fast. And Jim came from a family of lions who was partially slow. Okay. He was a lazy lion. Now, Jim's father had taught him how to hunt. He did not need to run fast because where he used to hunt, there used to be a lot of sheep. There used to be a lot of wild animals. But Jack's father taught him how to run very, very fast. And Jack's father thought that if he can run fast, he will be able to hunt well. Now, both these lions grew up. They became big. And it was time to decide who was the king of the jungle. Jack was very, very proud that he is a very fast runner. So he told that today I will run from one end of the forest to the other end of the forest and bring food for all the family members. Now, Jim, being the slower lion, he could not understand what to do. He also said, okay, if that is how you become the king, I will also bring food for all the lions. Jack ran from one end of the forest to the other end of the forest, and in his speed, he saw a lot of wild animals. But he thought, okay, I will find another bigger, you know, wild animal later because I can run fast and I can take it down. Jim went, he killed 5 or 6 small animals and he brought food for everyone. When Jack came back to their home, Jack's father told only one thing to Jim. Son, it's not how fast you run. It's completely fine if you run very slow, as long as you're running in the right direction. Okay? So please make sure that you are going slow, but at least in the first few passages, you are contemplating about it and you are making the summary of it. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, please take your time. Read it. So how many of you have completed the passage? Contraband Ishwar is any goods that have been brought illegally. They have been imported or exported illegally. Illicit. Who is asking this? Mohan Pavan Prasad. Illicit is something that is forbidden, Nana. Something that you shouldn't be doing. Okay. So, how much time did it take for you people to read this? And did all of you understand this passage? Cool. Let's go through this passage once. And let's see what he's talking about. Okay, the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer, signed in 1987 by more than 150 nations, has attained its short-term goals. It has decreased the rate of increase in amounts of most ozone-depleting chemicals reaching the atmosphere, and has even reduced the atmospheric levels of some of them. The projection that the ozone layer will substantially recover from ozone depletion by 2050 is based on the assumption that the protocol's regulations will be strictly followed. Yet, there's considerable evidence of violations, particularly in the form of the release of ozone depleting chlorofluorocarbons, which are commonly used in the refrigeration, heating, and air conditioning industries. These violations reflect industry attitudes. For example, in the United States, 48% of respondents in a recent survey of subscribers to air conditioning, heating, and refrigeration news, an industry trade journal, said that they did not believe that CFCs damage the ozone layer. Moreover, some in the industry, Some in the industry apparently do not want to pay for CFC substitutes, which can run 5 times the cost of CFCs. Consequently, a black market in imported illicit CFCs has grown. Estimates of the contraband CFC trade range from 10,000 to 22,000 tons a year, with most of CFCs originating in India and China, whose agreements under the protocol still allow them to produce CFCs. In fact, the United States Customs Service reports that CFC 12 is a contraband problem, second only to illicit drugs. Okay. So basically what he is telling is that there was some protocol, the Montreal Protocol. Don't ask me what is Montreal. Montreal is a place. Okay. So there was a protocol that was signed, some kind of an agreement that was signed in Montreal on the substances that deplete the ozone layer. Okay. Now, what according to this particular protocol, I'll give you a small history about this protocol in case you guys don't know about it. I'm pretty sure you must have studied this in your environmental studies. But still, if you don't know about it, let me tell you. Developing nations can produce up to a certain amount of carbon dioxide, but developed nations, for every amount of carbon dioxide they produce, they have to pay some money. Okay. Now, since India is a developing nation, we still have some, you know, flexibility to produce harmful gases that are depleting the ozone. Now, there are a lot of countries which are managing these kind of things with the another protocol called as the joint implementation. Okay, so basically, if I am a company in the United States and I'm having a factory in India, it's India's pollution and not the United States. Okay, so that's what we mean by joint implementation. Anyways, what are there any words in this particular passage that you guys did not understand? Contrabands are, you know, prohibited substances. For example, in your college, a mobile phone is a contraband. Okay, that means in your college, mobile phones are prohibited. Okay, illicit is illegal, Nana. Illicit is illegal. You can take illicit as illegal in this passage. Any other words that you people don't understand from this passage? So all of you have now understood, now gotten an idea of the passage, right? Yes. Okay. So now let's go for the questions. Question one. According to the passage, which of the following best describes the most ozone depleting chemicals in 1996 as compared to those in 1987? Come on, what do you think is the answer? Okay, I'm getting a lot of different answers. Now, look, what is he asking you specifically in the question? Which of the following best describes most ozone depleting chemicals? He's talking about ozone depleting chemicals and a comparison within these 2 years, correct? Okay, so let's go back and see what is the thing in, you know, 1987 and what is happening in 1996. In 1987, what was there? Over here, we signed the Montreal Protocol, correct? Now, where can I see 1996 at all? Is there 1996 mentioned in the passage anywhere? No, right? So why is he asking us about 1996 specifically in that case? To show us that what is the modification or what changed came out after Montreal Protocol, correct? Now, according to the passage, what do I know? We were supposed to see over here in this part. Can I see this part? The projection from this part to here. Okay. So short-term goals, it attained its short-term goals, which was it has decreased the rate of increasing amounts of most ozone depleting chemicals reaching the environment. This was a short term goal. And by 2050, this is a long term goal. Correct? That means this protocol could reach the short term goal, but not the long term goal. So please see, where can I find these lines? Where can I find these lines in an answer? I can find that in 4, right? All of you? I can find that thing in 4, fourth one, no? So your answer will be 4. Am I clear to all of you now? So this is how you have to form the thinking part in your reading comprehension. When you are reading a passage, you have to try and understand, okay, why is this guy telling? Okay, fine. Maybe I signed Montreal Protocol. Maybe I signed Montreal Protocol. In this Montreal Protocol, I'm getting 2 parts. One is a short-term goal. Kada. Second one is a long-term goal. No, Sai Ishwar, the questions might not always be given paragraph-wise. Luckily for us, this came paragraph-wise. Okay? Now, short-term goal ante somewhere around 1996, okay. Long-term goal ante, okay, 2050. This is achieved. This is not achieved. If not achieved, why? And then, how to achieve? So when you're reading the passage, if you can make a small flow chart like this, then it will become very, very easy. Okay? This is a direct question, Anna. This is not an implication. This is a direct question. Okay? So if you can make a flow chart like this, a very small flow chart is also okay. But if you can make a flow chart like that, then it will become very, very easy for you. Okay, let's quickly go to the second question. Second question is, the author of the passage compares smuggling of CFCs to illicit drug trade, most likely for which of the following reasons? Now, where did we talk about illicit drug trade and smuggling of this in the last paragraph, correct? Over here. The last line. From this part, in fact, the United States Customs Service reports that the CFC-12 is a contraband problem, second only to illicit drug trade. Correct? Yeah. So we identified correctly where we have that information. Now let's look at the option. Okay. What are the options? To qualify a previous claim, to emphasize the extent of a problem, to provide an explanation, to suggest that illicit CFC trade like will continue to increase, and 5, to suggest that the consequences of a relatively little known problems are as serious as those of a well-known one. Wow, nice. So good. He's given us good options. So this question I would classify as a moderate question. The previous question was easy. This question I'll classify as a moderate question. Now, in this question, most of you would be struggling with 2 options, that is 2 and 5. Okay? Now, see, definitely 3, 1, and 4 are not a right answer. Okay? Amongst 2 and 5, now we'll have to be very, very clear. Okay? Why either 2 or why either 5? For that, let me go back to the passage and show you one small word that maybe most of you must have missed. I'm going to use a yellow ink to highlight this word. Can you see this ink? The second only 2. Are you able to see the yellow ink, guys? Yeah, obviously, if you're able to see red ink, you'll be able to see yellow ink also, no? My bad. Anyways, so now see, in this we are saying it's second only, correct? Yeah, that means we are trying to compare it. Okay, and why are we trying to compare it? Because we know the problem, how serious it is with drug trade. Okay, we know that drug trade is serious issue. Okay, but we don't know how serious this normal CFCs are. That is why we are comparing and showing. Hence, your answer will become option 5. Am I clear to all of you? Boys and girls, my dear friends, are we able to understand this? Okay, all right. You want me to explain it once again? Okay, I'll explain it once again. Now, before I go forward, let me tell you why 4 is not the right answer. A few of you are asking about 4. So I'll tell you why 4 is not the right answer. See, over here he's saying likely the illicit drug trade will continue to increase. But nowhere in the passage did he mention about its increase or decreasing, no? He only is trying to tell us how serious that problem is, no? He's not trying to tell us if it will increase or not, no? So that is your assumption. But we are talking about the author's opinion, no? Not your opinion. Correct? Deepak, I'm not able to understand. He said second only to. When I say second only to, that means just next to. Okay, now? That means if I'm thinking that number one position in all the world problems is illicit drugs, then I'm telling you that number two is CFC 12. Now your question, okay, someone has asked me, if second only two wasn't mentioned, will the answer be option two? Yes, if second only two wasn't mentioned, then definitely the answer will be option two. Because in that case, we are only trying to see how wide is the problem. Now am I clear to all of you? Can I move forward to the next question? Okay, all right. Now, this is passage number 2. This passage is from Science and Technology again. The time in my watch is 4:01. Where's my pen? Okay. Yeah. So the time in my watch is 4:01. You guys can take up till 4:06 to complete this passage. Yeah, please start. Thank you. Harichandana, you took 4 minutes, huh? Look, this passage, I don't think you should be taking more than 2.5 minutes. So if you're taking 4 minutes, I would want you to go through a few biology passages, okay? Look, if you're taking more than 3 minutes for this passage, then I want you to go through a few biology passages, okay? Anyways, I'm waiting for the rest of you to finish it. Yeah, you should write the summary now itself, Na. Someone is asking me the meaning of dissemination. Dissemination is, how do you say? You spread things, right? You're spreading information. You're spreading something very widely. Anything you spread very widely is that. Na, I told you that in the early stages, after every paragraph, you should, write a summary. Once you come to a stage where you have done at least 20 to 30 passages constantly, then you don't need to do it anymore. Someone is asking me the meanings of sporadically. Well, sporadically is opposite to periodically. Okay? Sporadically is opposite to periodically. That means irregular intervals. Okay? And someone is asking me the meaning of fostered. Well, fostered in this case is to encourage or to develop. Okay? All right. So let's go through with this passage now. I'll be reading through this passage and I'll be explaining you this passage, and then we can go for the questions. Sorry, what? Sarada, I'm not able to read your message. It's not clear. I mean, it looks like gibberish to me on my screen. So can you please type that word again? The one that you've just typed. Anyways, let me just go through the passage, and then while I'm going through the passage, I'll explain you the meanings of a few more words. Okay? All right. So although genetic mutations, someone is asking inadvertent. Okay. Wait, I'll tell you. Inadvertent is basically accident. Okay? As in you did not want to do it unintentionally. Okay? Inadvertent is you did not want to do it, but it happened somehow. So it's unintentionally. Nana, adolescence is, it's an age, Nana. Adolescence is when you come to the age of 12 or something. Okay? Youngsters, young adolescent people, we say, right? Anyways, although genetic mutations in bacteria and viruses can lead to epidemics, some epidemics are caused by bacteria and viruses that have undergone no significant genetic change. In analyzing the latter, scientists have discovered that proliferate, guys, okay, I'll need you guys to just wait on the meanings for a bit, because when I'm explaining you the passage, I will tell you the meaning of that word either. Okay, and after the passage is done, I will definitely ask you if I've missed out any words, and I'll then explain you the meanings. Okay, is that okay? Because see, when I'm reading the passage, if you're asking me for the meanings, it's only going to take off my concentration. Okay. Anyways, inadvertent is accidentally, not. And someone has asked me, yeah, Varsha, proliferate kanna is nothing but, a rapid increase, a very, very exponential increase. For example, coronavirus nowadays is proliferating. I hate to give this example, but that's how it is. Okay. So it's a very rapid increase in something. So can I start with the passage now, all of you? Okay, thank you. So although genetic mutations in bacteria and viruses can lead to epidemics, some epidemics caused by bacteria and viruses that have undergone no significant genetic change. In analyzing the latter, scientists have discovered the importance of are social and ecological factors to epidemics. Poliomyelitis, for example, emerged as an epidemic in the United States in the 20th century. By then, modern sanitation was able to delay exposure to polio until adolescent or adulthood, at which time polio infection produced paralysis. Previously, infection had occurred during infancy, when it typically provided lifelong immunity without paralysis. Thus, the hygiene that helped prevent typhoid epidemics indirectly fostered a paralytic polio epidemic. Now, what does he mean by this? He's saying that there's a lot of times that virus and bacteria can cause, can undergo genetic mutation or changes in their structure and lead to very widespread disease. Okay? Shivram Pawan, no, proliferate does not mean to steal. Okay, proliferate is not stealing. So he's saying that some viruses and bacteria, they undergo changes to cause diseases. However, some other viruses, they don't need to undergo any genetic change. Next, what is he telling? He's saying that there's another factor that's very important. That's the social and ecological factor. For example, there was something called as a poliomyelitis. Okay. Now, this polio became an epidemic in the United States in the 20th century. And in 20th century, we had very good sanitation and all, no? See, right now, all of you are able to use hand sanitizers. If you ask me, like, not even 20, 15 years back, hand sanitizers was an alien concept to Indian crowd. People believed that, using hand wash was very posh. People only used soaps 15 years ago. Okay, because I remember this because every place I went to, there was a soap, but there was no hand wash. And I felt very weird that time. Okay, so anyways, so when we were looking at this, he says that the polio, which usually comes in infants, and when it comes in infants and you take proper care, it gives you a lifelong immunity. That means it protects you lifelong from paralysis. But because of all your modern sanitation and everything, when adults got polio, they became paralyzed. Okay. Next, what he's saying, another example is Lyme disease, which is caused by bacteria that are transmitted by deer ticks. It occurred only sporadically during the late 19th century, but has recently become prevalent in parts of the United States. Now, see, here sporadically means it occurred occasionally. It occurred very rarely. Okay. In the 19th century, apparently it was coming very rarely, but now it has become prevalent in many parts. And prevalent is present all the time. Okay, na eppudu undadu ante chaala ekkuva undadi ani. Largely due to an increase in the deer population that occurred simultaneously with the growth of suburbs and increased outdoor recreational activities. Okay. Now, what do you mean by that? Abundant. Abundant ante large in quantity na. Chala ekkuva ayindi ani. Okay. Now, what does he mean? This Lyme disease is supposed to come because of the bacteria transmitted by deer ticks. No, prevalent and abundant is not the same. Mashallah. Okay. So, this Lyme disease is supposed to be caused by bacteria that's transmitted by deer ticks. But it used to be happening only very rarely in the 19th century. Now it is present everywhere in the United States. Then he is giving you a reason, why is it present everywhere in the United States? First thing, deer population increased, okay? And how did that increase? It increased simultaneously with the growth of suburbs and increased outdoor recreational activities. Ante bayitikelli enjoy chese activities peragadam valla manaki emochi deer population kuda perigindi. Aa peragadam valla deer ticks perigayi. Deer ticks peragadam valla Lyme disease vachindi. Chala pedda link anamata. Anyways, similarly, an outbreak of the dengue hemorrhagic fever became an epidemic in Asia in the 1950s. Okay. Because of the ecological changes that caused Aedes aegypti, the mosquito that transmits the dengue virus. So Aedes aegypti is a name, okay? And hemorrhage is an escape from the blood vessels. guys, some of you people have asked me about hemorrhagic definition for hemorrhagic. So when a mosquito bites, you know, it's sucking the blood from your blood vessels, no? So that is called an hemorrhage. For example, have you ever heard of brain hemorrhage and all? Proliferate is not the disease, no. Proliferate ante spread avadam ani. Proliferate ante spread avadam. Okay, so anyways, the stage is now set in the United States for a dengue epidemic because of the inadvertent introduction, ante accidental introduction and wide dissemination of another mosquito, Aedes albopictus. Ante enti? Because now in the United States, there is an accidental introduction of a widespread of one more mosquito. A new mosquito is very widely spread in the United States. And what's the name of that mosquito? Aedes albopictus. Okay, that is why there is a good chance that US will have a dengue epidemic now. Okay, are we clear with this passage now? Okay, let's look at a question. So this is your question one. Five or four, or three, or two, or one. నేను అన్ని చెప్తాను, నాకేమి కరెక్ట్ ఆన్సర్ చెప్పాల్సింది మీరు కదా. ఇదిగో తొందర పడద్దు, ఆలోచించుకుని ఆన్సర్ చెప్పండి, కంగారు ఏం లేదు. One, show the passage, sir. Okay, give me a minute, I will show you the passage. Yeah, this is the passage here. Look, you guys have to understand the question properly. This is an implied idea question, this is not a direct question. A lot of you are saying 5 4 5 4. Okay, fine, I'll give you the answer to this. Now look, what is he saying? He's saying that the lack of, just give me one more. Hurry, oxide, dalpesindi. Okay, yeah. So the lack of modern sanitation would make which of the following most likely to occur, correct? So look, in the passage, where is he talking about lack of sanitation? Okay, look over here. It's there. Yes. Now look, what happened over here? He's saying that due to the lack of sanitation, by then modern sanitation was able to delay the exposure of polio, correct? But does that mean that if modern sanitation was not there, it will directly affect children? Is that correct? But you are not looking at the right part where the answer is from. Look at this part. Look at this small part and tell me. Does the hygiene that helped prevent typhoid epidemics indirectly fostered a paralytic polio epidemic? That means, what would have happened if there was no modern sanitation? There would have been an epidemic of typhoid. See, these 4 and 5 are just wrong answers that are placed very conveniently. Lot of students will think the answer is over here, but the correct answer is over here. Okay, so this is why I'm telling you, we should be able to form an opinion. Okay, so Now, how is the flowchart going to help you? I told you, if you make small flowcharts, it will help you. Let us say sanitation. Okay. Yes. No. No sanitation. Typhoid. Yes, sanitation. Again. Good sanitation. Bad sanitation. Bad sanitation. Young children. Good sanitation, old people, okay, or older people, okay. So, in this flowchart, if I make this flowchart, now he is asking me about this condition, no? So, my answer will be typhoid. Are you able to understand? So, when you are studying, if you are making small flowcharts like this, everything will get easier, okay? Come on, let's go to the next question. We don't have a lot of time. Okay. Yeah, please answer this question. Now, this is a direct question here. Sirisha, where did we talk about Aedes albopictus? Aedes albopictus is about what? US, no? But in the 1950s, where did this thing happen? Dengue hemorrhagic fever? In the Asia, no? Okay, you want to see the passage again, yeah? Okay, fine, no problem. Yeah. Look. 1950, whatever happened, let me take another color ink so that it'll be easier for you. So in 1950s, this was what happened in Asia. Okay. So now let's go back to our options and see. So in 1950s, what happened? Was it recently introduced? Was it newly introduced? No. It became numerous. Why? Because of the word proliferate. Correct? Yeah. So that will be the answer. Answer will be 2. Is this clear? All of you? Okay. Now let's go back to the next question. Let's go forward. And yeah. So, see guys, what I am observing in most of your answers is that you guys are not able to hold a lot of information in your head. And that happens because, well, either you have not read the passage with enough care, or you have tried to read the passage very, very fast. Now, please try to understand, you don't need to match my speed, okay? All I want you to do, that's why I'm giving you 5 minutes, in fact. All I want you to do is calmly read the passage and give me answers. See, there's no point in you reading the passage within 30 seconds if you are going to give me wrong answers. Correct? At the end of the day, in the exam, he won't ask you how much time did you take to answer this passage. He'll ask you how many correct answers did you get. So keep that in your mind and try to give me a right answer. Let's go to the third question. Oh, sorry, that was my bad. That's not the answer, it's just a bad answer, bad thing, bad ink. You want me to go back to the passage? I thought this will be an easy question, but okay. Here, I'm going back to the passage. Yes, for all of you who are giving me the answer as 5, yes, the correct answer is 5. Very good. Yeah, the correct answer is 5. And where do I understand that from? I understand that from the last but two lines in the second column. Correct? From there, if I see till the deer's habitat, till that part, we have our answer. Am I correct? Yes, second and third columns. Correct, Shravya. You're right. So let me go to the question so that you can see. Your answer, the correct answer is answer 5. Okay. All right. Should we do one more passage? We have 5 minutes. Can we do one more passage? Okay. All right. All right. All right. We'll do one more passage. Here. Passage 3. Please start. Durga Bhargava, yeah, sure. I will do one thing. Today I will upload this PDF and I also upload another PDF by tonight, which has 4 to 5 passages in it. Redefining is defining again. So making a new definition of something that is old. On redefining will be making a new definition of something that is old. Ishwar, I'm not able to get that message properly. Ishwar, can you please type that message again? Sorry, Ishwar, the last message that you typed, could you please type that again? I was typing another message, so I couldn't get that message. Oh, temperance. Where did you find that word in this passage? See, temperance usually means abstaining from alcohol, not drinking alcohol. Second column, huh? She concludes defining politics. Any action? Last sentence. Yeah, so temperance is basically abstaining from alcohol, Nana. Pioneered can mean started, pioneered can mean championed. It's basically a temperance ante mandu adle magic daagadunna anna. Okay, are we done with this passage, guys? Someone says that they have taken 4 minutes 27 seconds. So with the different vocabulary in the passage, I think you're getting a little bit more time, no? Yeah. Okay, so let's read through this passage and try to understand this. The new school of political history that emerged in 1960s and 1970s sought to go beyond the traditional focus of political historians on leaders and government institutions by examining directly the political practices of ordinary citizens. That means This new school did not want to only focus on the activities done by leaders or politicians, but they wanted to understand how the political movements of normal citizens are taking place. Like the old approach, however, this new approach excluded women. That means in the previous approach, that means when they were looking at the leaders and all also, they ignored women. Now also they're ignoring women. The very techniques these historians used to uncover mass political behavior in the 19th century United States, quantitative analysis of the election returns, for example, were useless in analyzing the political activities of women who were denied the vote until 1920. So basically, why did they ignore the entire women crowd? Because the women crowd could not vote until 1920, apparently. And all the analysis that they did was a quantitative analysis of the election returns. That means it was a number-wise analysis of election returns. Correct? Now, by redefining political activity, historian Paula Baker has developed a political history that includes women. She concludes that among ordinary citizens, political activism by women in the 19th century prefigured trends in the 20th century politics. That means when she was looking at the definition of political activity, she could not find an entire class or entire section of the society, that's the women section of the society, in the definition. So what she did is that she changed the definition. She redefined the definition for political activity. Now, according to Paula Baker, whoever that person is, we'll call her Paula. Not her personal ka deli, but how does it matter? Right. So according to Paula, she included women, and she said that by making this change in the definition, we are going to understand the 20th century politics trends better than the 19th century politics trends. Okay? So defining politics as any action taken to affect the course of behavior of government or of the community. Baker concludes that while voting and holding office were restricted to men, women in the 19th century organized themselves into societies committed to social issues such as temperance and poverty. Okay, so what happened? Baker said that, okay, in the 19th century anyways, that's not the only type of politics that women are doing. They are organizing themselves into small groups, small organizations. And what are these organizations working for? These organizations are working against the consumption of alcohol. They're working against poverty. Okay? In other words, Baker contends women activists were early practitioners of non-partisan, issue-oriented politics and thus were more interested in enlisting lawmakers, regardless of their party affiliation, on behalf of certain issues in ensuring that one party or other won an election. Now, what do we mean by this particular thing? When I'm telling you that these women, these people were non-partisan, issue-oriented politics. Partisan politics, remember, in my vocabulary class, I told you the meaning of this word partisan with the word adherent. So partisan politics is supporting only one particular party irrespective of what their opinions are. Okay, so Paula Baker is saying that these women activists, were the first people who were not supporting any parties. They were only looking at issues to be solved. Okay, and because they were looking at issues to be solved, they wanted to have lawmakers into politics. In the 20th century, more men drew closer to women's ideas about politics and took modes of issue-oriented politics that Baker sees women having pioneered. That means all the ideas that the women started in 20th century, a lot of men got closer to those ideas and they started using those ideas. Are we clear with this passage? Yes? Okay. All right. So now let's look at the first question. What is the primary purpose of this passage? Come on guys, what's the answer? My voice is not audible. My voice is not audible. Pawan, is my voice audible to you now? Pawan, are you able to hear me? Yeah, okay. Okay, cool. Got it. So guys, what's the answer? Okay, look, the first option says enumerate reason why both traditional scholarly methods and newer scholarly methods have limitations. Look, obviously from the passage we understood that the traditional scholarly methods have limitations. But what limitations did he show for new scholarly methods at all? He did not show any particular limitation, no? So first option is not going to be your answer. First option is not going to be your answer, Kanna. Okay. Identify a shortcoming in a scholarly approach and describe an alternative approach. Yes, this is what we've done, no? Especially if you look at the adjectives. We used adjectives like redefined, pioneering, and all, no? So because of that, we understand that they've described an alternative approach. So this is a good answer. Okay? So correct answer will be 2. All right? Okay, let's go to the next question. Okay, so you people are confused between 1 and 4. Okay.
So why are you confused between 1 and 4, Ishwar?
See, I agree that you are confused between 1 and 4, but the right answer...
Okay, so Paul Abeka was an important historian, yeah? Okay. So, my dear friends, let's come back to why we use punctuation marks, okay? Whenever I'm using these kind of punctuation marks, I'm trying to highlight something. This is to highlight something. Okay? So basically when I use these punctuation marks, I had a definition before and I have a definition after. And this is what is showing me the difference between the definition before and definition after. Now, none of you have given me the right answer to this, but the right answer to this question is 2. Okay? To differentiate between a novel, novel means new. We are saying novel coronavirus, no? Novel coronavirus, bari nunchi kaapadukondi ani meeku emochi eppudu vaadu phone ettagane cheptunnadu kada. So that novel is new. Okay. So the right answer is going to be answer 2. Okay, last question for the day. What do you mean by use a noun then? Sorry, sir, I'm not able to understand properly. Why use a noun then? No, sorry, Ishwar, please elaborate your question and send it to me. I could not understand from that small part. Noun ante em noun nana? The rest of you, please solve the question number 3. Oh, yeah, see, he just used Paula Baker name to give example of the new definition. Sai Ishwar, because Paula Baker was the one who studied the old definition and changed it to the new definition. He mentioned her name. No other particular reason. Okay. Yeah, the rest of you, please, please give me the answer to question number. Okay, a lot of you are giving me very random answers. Okay, good, good, no problem. Give me. Send me your answers. It's okay. Look, for this question, you can directly go back to the passage and see the answer. Look, until 1920, women were not allowed to vote. Okay? So, look at the first, very first line of this passage, Nana. Okay? Over here. The new school of political history that emerged in 1960s and 1970s sought to go beyond the traditional focus of political historians. Okay, they wanted to also examine directly the political practices of ordinary citizens. So from there, directly you can say that the answer will be 5. An emphasis on the political involvement of ordinary citizens. So this is a direct question. Okay, all right. So I hope all of you have understood how to... No, these passages are, some of these passages, well, the first two passages are taken from an NMAT exam kind of a paper. It's not exactly the NMAT exam paper, but it's an NMAT exam kind of a paper, which is used for CRTs as well. So these are at the level of, well, let's say, SI, how do I put it? It'll be at the level of SNAP, NMAT, and maybe your CRTs also. Okay. Yeah, GRE definitely is. GRE, you don't get tougher passages. GRE have a lot of vocab-based questions. That's the challenge. Okay. So GRE is not a tough exam. In my opinion, GRE is a pretty easy exam to crack. Very, very honestly speaking, it's one of the easiest exams that you can write in India to go abroad. But yeah, your vocab needs to be good. Okay, all right. Anyways, I hope all of you, you want me, Sai Ishwar, you want me to repeat the last question? Okay, look, Nana, what is he asking? According to the passage, Paula Baker and new political historians shared which of the following? That means Paula Baker also should believe in it, and new the historians of 1960s and 1970s should also believe in it. So, look over here. This is what the new school people believe. You want me to explain the before one? Are you talking about the second question? Ishwar, is it the second question you want me to repeat? Okay. So, see, what's he asking? He's asking that the author passages the quote Baker directly in the second paragraph. What is that quote, Nana? Look over here. He's saying that by redefining political activity, correct? Yes. So that thing, and over here, defining politics as any action taken by the government to the effect of the course of behavior of government of our community, correct? So this is what he's quoting Paula Baker in. Now, why is he doing that? Because initially, we had another different definition. Where was that definition? Over here, look.
the very techniques these historians used to uncover mass political behavior in 19th century United States was quantitative analysis of election returns. Okay, so this was the old definition. Now he changed, this Baker, this woman, changed the definition to this new definition. Okay, and that is why we are quoting that new definition. So that's why the answer is option two. Am I clear now? Okay, all right. So with this, we'll stop today's class. All right. So you guys can, well, practice a lot of RCs from anywhere you want. But if you want, you can go onto our website. By tomorrow, I will be able to upload a few more RCs for you, almost like 5 to 10 RCs. You can solve them and you can easily get in touch with me over WhatsApp. Okay. All right, guys. Take care. Have a good evening. And let's meet tomorrow again. Bye-bye.